Welcome to Between Two Pastries, a not-so-typical nutrition podcast. Nicole and Annie are licensed and registered dietitians. Join them as they discuss hot nutrition topics, challenge popular beliefs, and have a blast doing it. Here are your hosts, Nicole and Annie.
Welcome to Between Two Pastries. This is Nicole.
Hey everyone, it's Annie.
That's probably one of the most lowest energy intros I swear we've ever done. We were just talking about how, well, I was talking about how I'm slightly fatigued today.
It's making me yawn.
I know. We're going to bring the energy here.
Oh, let's try.
So today we decided that we would talk about myths and gosh, we could just, there's so much that we could, you know, get into.
You know, you say the word myth and it makes me think about, like, I've had so many people over the years ask questions like, is tuna healthy? Is peanut butter good for me? Where they like, they have heard a myth in their head. Or, you know, obviously we were talking about earlier, my favorite myth is appearing heavier than usual means you're not going to be able to run well.
Sure.
Rather, the myth is that weight impacts running performance.
Yes, that's a huge myth.
That one would be crazy. And of course, I have those haters who come at me like, well, if you were, you know, 300 pounds, you wouldn't be able to run. Well,
oh boy.
I'm talking about here, people. Like, give me a break. And frankly, I know actually quite a lot of people who are in the, you know, upper 200s who run just as well as someone who's in the upper 100s, you know, so I struggle with that whole myth. So I think it's a good topic.
Important. With that being a myth, I also had another new client that I just started working with, and he connected with me because he's trying to embark on some weight loss, and his concept is I have to eat a particular amount of macros. And you know, this guy was again using the tools that are out there, unfortunately. And you know, for a dude that's like 5'9" and say 250 pounds, he's like, I figured I need to eat about 1400 calories.
You know, people, I don't think people realize these tools are free for a reason.
but you know, so we got in this whole subject. And so I think where I'm kind of going with this is, yeah.
Is he 12 years old?
I know. That's what I was thinking. I'm like, Well, you know, that works if you're literally, yeah. But so, you know, kind of to go back and forth a little bit with him in regards to that. And then he was finally kind of coming around to understanding, you know, that, you know, the last thing we want to lose is the muscle you have, because, you know, even if your body composition is at, you know, 30, 40%, you still have like 170 pounds of muscle on you. And it's like, that will be the first thing that will go in this situation, because, you know, depending on, you know, where he's at. And again, we just had some conversation. I actually see him in a couple of weeks, but since he was like doing this stuff, I was like, oh my gosh, I want to stop the train wreck here and conserve this dude's, you know, muscle mass until we can really dive into things. And I'm like, hey, just hang on a bit. Let's just adjust a few things for you. And, you know, fine if you're going to do, you know, whatever you're going to do until I see you. But, you know, anyway, you know, but this whole concept is, you know, we don't, you know, and he was like, again, he's only been doing this for a couple of weeks, but he's losing like 3-4 pounds a week. And I'm like, no, you know, you're losing muscle and you're losing a lot of water. And the thing is it's going to backfire on you, you know, 1000% in the end and blah, blah, blah. So
I think people think though, that when you say that, you know, I lost water weight or I'm losing water, the way I envision people thinking about it and the way that people seem to just like how they seem to conceptualize it, or like from what they tell me, I'm gathering that a lot of people think it's like they're, you know, unscrewing a faucet of their body and water pours out.
Yeah.
That's not like, I don't think people understand what it means to have fluid in your muscles and how good that is to have fluid around those areas of your body and to have fluid well throughout your whole body, and that when you lose water weight, that's not a good thing. Mm-hmm. When you like, and when you gain water weight, mm-hmm. that's a hormonal change. Mm-hmm. That's a sign of a lot. I mean, we don't have to get into
it. Oh, I know. My gosh. Signs,
but like, there's so much that I don't think people scientifically understand about water weight. And if they did, they would not engage in this behavior of 3 to 4 pounds of water coming off of you.
Completely. That's just it. I know.
If they understood the importance of it.
Well, and then the other concept was, you know, he had said, okay, on days that I weight train, then I'll just make sure I have a protein shake. And I'm like, mm-hmm. again, we have a lot to talk about. We have a lot to work on, you know, so we haven't quite gotten there yet, but that's the other myth is what I want to say. It's like, it's protein doesn't equate to holding on to your muscle. It's calories and it's having enough carbohydrate in order to do that. And the timing of everything is what's key. And that's still what people don't get. So anyway, that was kind of another myth too, just to kind of, you know, dispel that.
Well, and that myth perpetuated from gyms. 100%.
Oh gosh, yeah.
That myth came from selling gym memberships and gym products.
Right.
Period. Eating more protein is not, eating more protein than what you actually need is 100% unnecessary.
Yeah. And it's happening a lot.
Oh, mm-hmm. It happens a lot. Across the board. Males, females, kids. It's like ridiculous, this whole push for protein. But really, I mean, you do some resistance training, you do yoga, you're going to end up with the toning that you want. And like you said, it all of it comes down to the timing in which you eat different things to create that look. And also hormones play a big role in there. Obviously you're the guru on that. And I think people really have failed to understand, our endocrine system. They've failed to understand what it is, what it means to be a female and to be a male, and what the aging
I would agree
is like.
Yeah, I would agree.
We've been convinced, and obviously I'm going on a tangent here from myths, mm-hmm. but we've been manipulated and convinced by the beauty industry that mm-hmm. if you're aging, that's not okay.
Right. Oh my gosh.
There's all the things you need to buy and do in order to look younger. And that, well, if this person is 75 years old, look at their skin and they're not overweight. Guess what? Yep. They were at some point and it's being manipulated.
Completely.
Again, it's just normal human functioning that this happens and that we have metabolic changes in the aging.
I know.
So, but I mean, ultimately you're correct. It is 100% a myth. Eating more protein or a ton of protein is not going to lead to larger muscle development mm-hmm. because I mean, what we know is protein doesn't digest fast at all. Mm-hmm. And so it's just going to get transferred into fat anyways, if it's overconsumed.
If it's overconsumed, and typically if someone isn't eating enough, that protein gets turned into carbohydrate. That's what people don't get. It's like, that's what happens. But if they're not eating enough and excess protein is turned into carbohydrate, it's still not enough to conserve your muscle mass. It might be enough to fuel your brain.
Yeah,
because that's how low people are lacking sometimes, but it's not enough to. So then you're gonna lose your muscle, and that's just what people just so struggle with understanding. Which is also another reason why we need to make sure we have enough carbohydrate in our day.
Right. Well, and I'm. How many myths are there around sugar and carbohydrate? I mean,
mm-hmm. countless.
Which one shall we start with? I mean, it's ridiculous, the myths out there around sugar. Or how about, like, you know, you were talking earlier about added sugar. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Fairly certain that the fear around added sugar is out of control at this point.
Yeah. Yeah, I would say so too, but also people not understanding what an added sugar is versus a naturally occurring sugar and putting them all into the same basket and just deciding that it's easier to say it all is bad when it isn't.
Correct.
I think, is it important that we're aware of added sugars that we might be consuming in a day? Sure. I think being aware of what you eat is important, period. And in the same token, if you don't know how to discern what's an added, or if it's starting to consume your life,
right,
when it also doesn't need to, because chances are, again, if you're eating predominantly, you know, like we talk about, if you're eating predominantly balanced, or the majority of what you're taking in is whole food, and you occasionally have, or you have cereal every day, or you have a yogurt every day, or you decide you have a dessert every day or something, that is an overkill. Right. And that's not something that we need to even be considering. That's the thing.
Right.
Like it's one thing if you're having, and again, just forgive me on this one, Annie, because I'm going to use a high sugar cereal at breakfast. But then like you'll have, you know, three sodas a day on top of that. And you have, I don't know. I don't even know what else we'd even have added sugar in that you would have to be even concerned about.
That's just it. Like, what has added sugar? In order to make soda, there's sugar. That's mm-hmm. how you create it.
Right.
That's food science. If you're having a dessert, mm-hmm. X amount of sugar goes into the cake and X right. amount goes into the frosting.
Right.
That's just what it is. There's okay. nothing added to it.
I know.
It doesn't have juice.
Right.
It's just juice. And in right. order to make it a certain way, there is sugar
right.
naturally occurring. And there's also then sugar that might be added to it, depending on if it's
right.
from concentrate or whatever it is.
Right.
And the only food item that I can literally think of on the top of my head where I think has added sugar is some brands of juice.
That, sure. That juice and yogurt and some yogurt.
Other than that,
I know.
I can't literally think of like a load of food with added sugars that's purposefully added in outside of what should naturally be there, or what makes that food what it is.
What it is, right. That's
right.
the thing. What makes that food what it is.
Cake has sugar. Deal right. with it. That's what cake is.
Right. And it's such a good point. And I was thinking the other day too, actually, while I was baking, and sometimes I modify what I bake a little bit, but not entirely, to be honest. But I was thinking to myself, I don't know how I got thinking, but I was making these cookies, and I thought, this is so interesting, because we were just talking about the sugar issue too.
Yeah.
And I kind of like did my own math in my head, and I'm like, I realize that there's less than a teaspoon of sugar in each of these cookies that I'm making. And it's a non issue.
That in a cup of coffee.
Well, here's the deal. And this is another informative thing for people to understand. It takes 12 grams of sugar, carbohydrate, if you will, to affect the blood sugar, period.
Yes.
Anything under 12 grams doesn't even affect your bloodstream.
Correct.
Like, it doesn't do anything. So one of my cookies or whatever
right.
isn't even going to affect. But that's the whole thing, is that you will find all this stuff that instills fear with people without backing up with the actual education around what it actually is. Let's
right.
not talk about what the truth is of this stuff. Let's just dive right into this is why you want to avoid it, and this is all the things you should be afraid of. Not here's some awareness around it. Not a big deal, but as long as you're not having an entire cake for breakfast, lunch, and dinner with three sodas in a day and a bowl of cereal for a snack.
maybe that does happen once in a while.
Sure, because what if you're running 100 miles in a day? I mean,
what if I'm traveling and access to, like, it's okay that might happen, and people like,
that's right.
100. 2 points, Nicole. Number
yep.
one.
Yep.
Do you put protein powder in your bakery?
First of all, do you know how gross that is?
Yeah,
there is nothing that turns out good there. There is nothing that turns out good.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure before I started bashing it, because
no, bash it. It's fine.
The worst thing I hear about is when people are like, oh, I baked muffins or pancakes or or cookies or whatever you're baking. Yeah, I added protein powder and replaced the, you know, they modify. And what kills me, and I think it kills every food scientist out there, is when people modify to the point where like people don't understand the properties of heat and like salt and sugar.
Right.
And when you put salt and sugar, like
right.
the chemical reaction, like
right.
it's basic chemistry, right?
Right.
So like,
right.
And that's fine. People don't have to understand it. Mm-hmm. But again, this industry has created, to stay on topic, all of these myths that
right.
like, well, applesauce in place of oil is healthier
mm-hmm.
because it doesn't have fat. And therefore mm-hmm. you won't get fat if you make this recipe this way. So
right.
now we've taught people that fat is bad. Then you've got people, in order to eat this chocolate chip cookie, I got to add all this protein in because that makes it healthier now by having this protein in there. And I need to manipulate this, this, and this.
Yep.
There's so many myths.
Mm-hmm.
Whether I guess we could call them myths, we could call them fears, fear mongering,
yep.
poor education. I don't know.
Right.
But the modification and manipulation of recipes that people are currently doing makes me, and I know
yeah.
it makes you nuts
yeah.
to see cauliflower, pizza crusts,
yeah.
and
right.
all of that garbage.
So the thing about that, and I feel like this is kind of the point, what I'm finding is that when people choose to do that, all of a sudden now they're using those items as a meal.
Yeah.
Now mm-hmm. they're using those as some kind of nutrition source
oh,
where
weird.
It's like, wait a minute. If we're doing that, now we're training ourselves to respond to that type of
right.
choice. In instead of keeping those items for what they are. They're a palate changer. They're a dessert. They're a 10% of your meal type of a situation. They're all they are is a change of flavor. They're not meant to actually sustain you. Do you know what I'm saying? You don't
yeah.
sit down to eat a cake.
No, but because I added protein powder, now I can.
Now I can. That's what I mean. It's like we are. I mean, I'm sorry, but why do people love a good mind F? You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Why aren't we just dealing with, I want dessert and I'm effing afraid of it?
Do you know what we got last night?
Ugh.
Brian and Kid went to Gilly's and got a grab bag. So it's like, you know, they put like random like ice cream cup things in a
sure.
bag. And you pay $5 for a bag, right?
Yeah.
Well, it
yeah.
was the end of the night and they're like, well, we have 4 left. We'll give them to you for $10. So like they get home and I'm like, what's in here? And I pull out all the different things and we all just tried a little bit of
yeah.
some of them and so, you know, and I don't think none of us consumed one whole one.
Right.
We all just, and it was enjoyable and it was, this is so fun. This one
yeah.
has bananas and this has sprinkles and this is caramel and
yeah.
whatever.
It's like it's a non-issue.
Shouldn't be this, oh my God, that's not healthy, that has fat, oh my God.
It's
and
ridiculous.
All of a sudden, for somehow in majority of people's lives, and don't, if you're not one of them, I would argue with you, we flip to, let's use this example, ice cream or custard in this case, is so fun and I love it, to that's the scariest thing on the planet. And
mm-hmm.
what, in order to go from comfortable to scary, we believe all of the myths along the way and we
mm-hmm.
create fear, and fear is developed, and how we get rid of that fear is, that's the $1 million question, right?
Right.
How long it takes, how we do that. And,
right.
you know, if we stop believing the fear or the myths rather,
mm-hmm.
but again, people just believe every headline that's out there.
I know.
I mean, I, again, we talked about this in our cereal podcast that like they use the words they use to,
right.
you know,
get your attention, to instill
yeah.
an emotion. That's the whole concept. We want to get people feeling things. We want to make them uncomfortable. We want to make them thinking about stuff. We want to, it's like they're planting a concept that doesn't actually exist.
Correct.
Yeah.
Well, and leading, you know, from this conversation, you know, around, you know, telling my story about custard and what we were talking about prior,
mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
we talk about that myth that like, in order to lose weight, I can't indulge on
right.
desserts. I have to put the protein powder in the cake
right.
or remove all the oil
right.
or whatever.
Right.
But really the fact of the matter is, if you're eating in balance, and create space for the foods that we love.
Yeah.
We're not going to see that physiological change, that like weird connection to quote unquote forbidden foods.
Literally.
Which causes us to, you know, overconsume them. People, come on.
I know.
Eat nachos the way that they're made.
Right, right, right.
We don't need cauliflower in place. That's weird. That's disordered.
And part of it too is, again, people not even knowing like what they want anymore, yeah. If that makes sense. Okay. This is a story when my girlfriend brings it up occasionally, we laugh about it. We had met for, me and my girlfriend went for breakfast one time. And I said to her, I'm like, you know, Nick, I said, I don't even know what I feel like eating this morning. So I literally ordered one of everything, and I'm not even kidding you. And we laughed so hard. So I was like, I ordered pancakes, I ordered an omelet, I ordered oatmeal, and I ordered a cinnamon roll because I didn't really know what I wanted. So what I did, so then I ended up, we were laughing. We just laughed so hard. And, but I love leftovers. And, yeah. You know, but my point is that's balance. So right. I had a little protein. I had a couple of bites of each of the carbohydrate pieces. I got the flavors I wanted. I was fully satisfied. I probably ate whatever, not even a quarter of everything. Do you know what I'm saying? Because right. It didn't matter. Like, it doesn't matter. No. And I took it home. I literally ate off of it for the week because right. It was like certain flavors I wanted or certain, you know, yep. But the point is like, the concept, if someone's thinking about that, like, oh my gosh, I could never do that because it A means I have to eat it all.
I have to eat it all then.
Or, right. Or
it's forbidden food.
Right.
And the myth that people keep believing is that if I want to lose weight, I can't eat things I love.
Right. That's or the I whole won't thing.
Be if I eat cake, I won't be healthy.
Right. Right. So
we come back to that example again, and that is a myth or a rule, if you will, because I don't think there's a big difference anymore between myths and rules.
No, I agree with you.
The industry has figured out that if we create these myths, mm-hmm. people believe them and they follow it, and it now becomes a rule. And once it becomes a rule, they will continue to purchase, buy, do the things that we want them to do.
Of course. And that's what it's designed to do. Right. It's a business.
Correct.
It's a business.
Correct.
So, you know, it has so little to do with health. And when you think about health, it's like sometimes I feel like the health, we're talking about the mental health of our society, you know, the physical health of our society, I feel like has gotten worse.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily better with all of our advancements.
That's awful.
You know what I'm saying? Like because of that whole purpose, you know, or because of that whole statement that you just made.
Right. Can we knock out this myth out of the park? The eating after X time, 7 p.m. leads to weight gain or is unhealthy. That's probably my second favorite.
Yeah.
Is when people tell me how, well, I don't eat anything after 8 p.m. because that's not okay. Why? Are you awake till midnight? Well, yeah, but I'm not supposed to eat after 8. Okay. Where'd you hear that? Like, it's so ridiculous where people come up with this stuff, but that myth has been around since probably the late 90s.
Right.
I mean, that one was probably one of the first ones that I think
right.
came out to the public as, well, you're gaining weight because you're eating after this time.
Right. Right. And the thing that again, these are the things that aren't taken into consideration. What's the lifestyle? What's your work schedule? Are you a night owl? Right.
Apparently people must be really into magic because we begin to store fat, apparently.
Right. Instantly.
We store fat when it's dark out, apparently.
Right. 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 Right.
It's just right. ridiculous.
Well, it is ridiculous. It is ridiculous.
Frankly, I mean, really what you see is under eating and overeating, you know, early in the day, late in the day.
Mm-hmm.
And someone tells you, well, you know, don't eat after this time and that'll stop you from overeating.
Right.
But it never actually corrects the problem that's going on, which is likely you're eating too little during the day.
That's correct.
You know, I mean,
that's why you're choosing to eat all of your calories at night. Yes, of course.
Right.
Oh my gosh. The other thing too is that I want to bring up, we're talking about myths, and I don't even know how to even say this one, but the whole concept of if I, you know, went out to eat and drank, like I gained weight. So I think a client said that to me, like, oh, and when, you know, I gained weight, and I'm like, wait, what? So right, like because they, night, because why are you weighing yourself? Like who, like, I mean, first of all, you don't instantly gain body fat overnight. It literally doesn't happen.
That's body why scales do not exist.
That's right. That's the whole thing. I mean, you know, anytime we eat differently, I'm not talking about labeling eating good or bad. I'm not talking about that at all because there is no such thing, right? But it, whenever we choose to eat differently than we have been on a regular basis, we have water changes, right? All the time for various reasons. Oops. I mean, there's a plethora of reasons.
I mean,
and all those things are not bad things.
No.
So anyway, you don't instantly gain weight from anything. It happens over.
You know when you do though, is what? After you run a race.
Oh my gosh!
I can't tell you. I have to keep exercising. I can't recover because I will gain weight.
Right.
There is such a disconnect with the athletic, specifically the running community, that thinks that they have to, they can't recover after their 100 miler, 50 miler marathon because they gain weight in the week after. Yes, you do. That's normal. That's physiology.
It makes me feel so sad that those poor bodies are being so deprived and can't heal appropriately.
More weight by not recovering. So aggravating because what's happening is you're holding on to water. Your muscles have to heal. They get, when you're using your muscles like that, they are getting like little tears in them. They're being used. All of the things with your muscles is happening. And so water comes in there, water and electrolytes come in there to help repair. It's got to fix everything. It's got to get you back to normal. You are going to gain weight after you do that big race or whatever. And it could be a short race. It doesn't even have to be big.
Right.
It's just, it's mind blowing to me. The fear around weight.
I know.
That's all
I know
down to, right. That's what all these myths have to do with are weight.
Literally
people's fear of weight gain. The other one too, I think, I don't know if we mentioned at the start, but I know we were talking about before, just staying on the athletic side of things, is that myth that, you know, weight affects your running ability or your athletic ability. And that's another one that I think, I think we did talk about that one. That's a tough one for me to swallow too. And you, I mean, you know, my personal history with that. And it's just like, if weight was an indicator of performance, I would not be the athlete I am then. Right. Or I would need to be 20 pounds thinner apparently to do what I currently do at my current weight.
Right. Right. Right.
I don't think so.
Not at all.
So, but I'm battled with how to convince people of that, even after telling them the evidence and the science.
Yeah.
That's how brainwashed people are, I think, because they're reading health magazine or listening to nutrition coaches or whatever.
Yeah, I would agree.
What they're doing.
I would agree.
Sources, whatever.
Right. So. Right. And let's, we might as well put a plug in for this. And let's keep in mind that anybody who calls themselves a coach doesn't have to have a credential in anything, doesn't have to actually have knowledge in anything.
Right. Because an online certification is not a credential.
It is not a credential, period.
Not even a little bit. A degree is not a credential.
Oh. That is just it.
Right. I know.
All right. Well, we hope this was of some service for all of you.
A sliver.
And if you guys hear of any other myths that you want debunked, definitely let us know for sure. We're happy to do it for you. Thanks, guys.
Have questions you want to hear discussed on the show? Find us on Facebook or visit betweentwopastries.com and drop us a line. Want to support the show? Find us on Patreon for exclusive content. If you love the show, find us on iTunes or your favorite podcast platform. Hit the subscribe button and leave us a review.